What we now know as Waikauri Bay is shown on marine charts as Christian Bay, and until a few years ago was just a lonely and deserted inlet, part of a large farm property on the Takatū Peninsula. Tens of thousands of yards of shingle were removed from the beach by barge. And on one of these barges worked as a younger man, one Tudor Washington Collins. In due course, he became the owner of the 500-acre property in which Waikauri Bay is cradled. And here's the character who sold the 40-acre beach area to what is now known as Waikauri Bay Reserve Limited. In 1953, he gave the Orrin Grants and the Whitmores permission to build batches on the beach frontage, and shortly afterwards, Kath and Bill Riley pitched a tent. In 1960, force of circumstances made Tudor decide to subdivide the beach property and the surrounding hillside sections with their wonderful panoramic views. And the batch owners of that day, about a dozen in all by that time, had to decide whether to get in or out. They decided to get in, and so Waikauri Bay Reserve Limited came into being. At that stage, there were 10 shareholders and 15 sections still to be sold. Fishing has always been one of the most popular pastimes in the bay. Fishing in those early days was not quite so scientific as today, nor so expensive. Then a 6-foot dinghy was medium sized. And of course, Orrin Grant's 12-footer, all nicely varnished with a 2.5-horsepower Seagull motor, was just the last word. Shortly after these shots were taken, this boat had its stern torn off in the gale, but Orrin, with his usual Kiwi ingenuity, cut 2 feet off the end of the wreck and made it into a 10-footer. There always seemed to be plenty of small fish in the bay. All that was required was a good organizer, a net, and a couple of rowers. Piper seemed to be plentiful right throughout the year, and good brigged sprats, which were used for baits, were there by the hundred. Cleaning the piper was part of the organizer's fun. Some intrepid souls used to venture far afield, almost halfway to Kaua, which seemed as far as the moon in those days. On one of these pioneer voyages, they landed a shark, and for those of us who had never conducted an autopsy on a shark, the results were quite colourful and illuminating. However, sprats, shacks and piper were not the only fish caught by the natives then. The Grants, the Rileys and the Whitmores led the field in the snapper stakes, probably because there were no other competitors. In the pioneer days, before the advent of Smoky Snowden, we had to smoke our own surplus as there was no deep freezers nor fridges. And this was a fairly full day's work for most of the natives and their families. This is a far cry from today with Orrin Grant's computerised pressure cooker system which fixes them in 20 minutes flat. Taking the fish out of the smokehouse was quite a ritual, and all hands were on deck. Of course, nothing was allowed to go out to the customers unless it had been personally sampled by the operators. However, fishing was not always possible. The wind would get round to the southeast and stay there for days. The seas would get up, and although men row single-handed across the Atlantic, we elected to stay on shore. Floating logs have always been a problem and have caused considerable erosion as they swept in on the bigger waves with a battering ram effect on the gravel banks. These, of course, were unprotected then. Thank you. There were often exciting episodes at sea, and even the Coast Guard had its problems in the huge surf. Only a beach cottage does not mean lying in the sun all day long. Things have to be done, and what better time to do them than when the seas are untidy? Orrin could always fill in the odd day or so with a paintbrush, wielding it with the skill of an old master. Riley repairs his crayfish pot ready for tomorrow's big haul while Lynn watches the operations. Our boys use the kitchen table to try out their Christmas presents before the novelty value wore off. However, the sun always shines again, and Orrin puts his paintbrushes away and takes his granddaughter down to the beach. The water beckons. And it isn't hard to fill in the odd hour or so basking in the sun after a swim. Seagull Island, a few hundred yards offshore, is a nesting place for seagulls and kawa birds. It is also a habitat of the famous prairie oyster, but you must take your own whistler source. If you arrive there at a mealtime, you may be fortunate enough to see the parents feeding the chicks. When these chicks are young, the adult birds are aggressively protective, employing mild dive bombing tactics to scare away intruders. Each chick seems to have a bodyguard of dozens of adults. Maybe they're not quite sure who the real dad is. On odd occasions, when Freddie Lab and his amphibian had an hour or two to spare while waiting for guests to have lunch at Kauau, he would slip over to Waikauri. He would set up in business on the beach with his 10-minute trip for a couple of dollars, or as it was in those days, 10 minutes for a pound. He always seemed to have plenty of customers. Thank you. A mild, harmless form of ski fever hit the bay in the early 50s. An unsophisticated piece of three-ply towed behind a 12-foot boat powered by a 7.5-horsepower motor was all the equipment the intrepid skiers of that day had. At least they could get up, however. Later came more powerful motors, bigger boats, sophisticated skiers, and plenty of helpers. It wasn't long, however, before most of the keen ones mastered the sport, and some of them got up on their first attempt. Then the boats got bigger and faster still, and the skiers more expert. However, the younger ones have simplified the procedure somewhat, and this certainly looks much more relaxed. It is indeed fortunate that man hours do not really count for much at the bay during the holidays. If they did, the erection in 1967 of Fisherman's Wharf by Working Deep Bay would have cost as much as the Grafton motorway. Depending on the weather, New Year's Eve or New Year's Day is set aside for sports for the children. This usually involves the committee in a trip to Warkworth to buy the prizes, sausages and soft drinks for the barbecue which follows. One of the most exciting parts of the day is wondering whether the committee will get back from the Warkworth Hotel before the sports are over. Boat races have recently been added to the program. These additional events, of course, called for more officers and stewards. Probably from the children's point of view, the best part of the day is the sausage sizzle. New Year's Eve, of course, is not made for the children alone, and some of the dads and mums unbend a little from time to time as the evening wears on. Next day is time to take it easy, and what better way than with a glass of beer and a pipe in the morning sun. Unless, of course, you prefer some exercise, golf or something like that. Keep that behind him, lady. My wife, however, says that for some there is no time to relax. Three meals a day, 365 days a year, that is a total of 1,095 meals, to be cooked commencing from January the 1st. I still think she loves it that way, however. Unfortunately, we can't relax in the sun forever. Waikauri Bay sojourns come to an end, and the time arrives all too soon to pack up the gear, hitch up the caravan, and it's back home again to an overgrown garden and collars and ties and the jobs that we left undone before Christmas and have tried to forget.